Hello, I'm Scott Neigh, and this is Talking Radical's Book Talk Project. Today I'm going to be talking about Light in the Dark, Luz en lo Oscuro, Rewriting Identity, Spirituality, Reality by Gloria E. Anzaldua. It was edited by Emma Louise Keating and published in 2015 by Duke University Press. I feel uneasy reviewing this book. I feel uneasy because I'm not entirely sure what to make of my relationship to this book or to the work of this author more generally. Now, that shouldn't be taken to indicate some sort of lack of regard or enthusiasm for Anzaldua. I think she's great. I think she is a brilliant thinker and an amazing writer. There is a piece of her writing that I first encountered more than 15 years ago, I think, in a multi-author collection, and in fact it also appears as the last chapter in this book, that profoundly affected me at a moment where I was going through some difficult things. And if you look back on my blog, one of the earliest posts way back in 2004 when blogging was a new phenomenon in the world, I wrote a short one noting and mourning Anzaldua's passing. And in the years since then, I've read a few things both by Anzaldua herself and also by Keating, who draws significantly on Anzaldua's work in her own writing, that have had an impact on me. I'm not saying that I've necessarily taken up their ideas in a way that they would recognize or approve of, but they have had an impact. And I would also say that I find Anzaldua as a person inspiring, particularly her commitment to both radical intellectual work that she mostly did outside of the academy, and her commitment to writing as a craft. Now, I'm not claiming that I am capable of even a fraction of what she was capable of in those areas, but I am inspired by her example. However, there are also elements of her work that don't speak to me in quite the same way. Things that just don't inspire the same excitement in me, or things that are addressed to experiences that I simply don't have. And I know that in situations where that's the case, it's very easy to fall into taking up the parts that excite you, downplaying or ignoring the bits that don't feel as relevant, and in doing that, ending up with a simplified and whitewashed picture of the ideas in question that end up being, you know, it ends up being kind of disrespectful and politically troubling. And in this book in particular, there are definitely parts that really speak to me, that really sort of got inside and evoked lots of feelings, lots of thoughts, and really felt like useful things that I could take up. And there were other elements that felt like, well, I mean, it's not like I don't respect the work or the person who produced them, but it's more that I recognize that they aren't ideas that I can take up and use in a simple and direct way, so I need to be kind of respecting and learning from them at a distance. And I'll talk a little bit more about what I mean by that in a minute. And I think that this is probably the best approach that I can take to navigating my encounter with this piece of work. I mean, I could choose to not engage with it at all, and I don't think that would be a good idea, or I could engage with it and kind of paper over the ways in which I differed from it, or I found it difficult, or wherever, and I don't think that's a really very useful thing to be doing either. So I think of the options available, this is a reasonable one, but I also recognize that there are probably implications, political implications, intellectual implications, of this way of navigating my encounter with this piece of work that I just don't get. And that makes me uneasy. So, with that proviso in mind, let me talk a little bit more about the book, Light in the Dark. So Gloria Anzaldua was a radical writer and activist and thinker. She was active in the women's movement, in the Chicano and Chicana liberation movement, in queer organizing in the US context. And she first became widely known as the co-editor of a foundational women of color feminist text, This Bridge Called My Back, which came out in 1983. This book is her final book. In fact, she hadn't quite finished it when she died about 15 years ago, not quite 15 years ago. Anzaldua had a notoriously intense and rigorous and lengthy writing process, and she had gotten this work most of the way through that process, but not quite all of the way through that process by the time she died. Anna Louise Keating is a scholar and an activist herself, and she had a long relationship with Anzaldua as a collaborator, and I think to some extent Anzaldua was a mentor of Keating's, and she took on the task of taking this mostly finished work and giving it that final push, that final bit of polish, to take it to the level, to the quality that Anzaldua herself insisted on for her analysis and her writing before it was sent out into the world. And in doing this, I have to say, Keating does a pretty effective job of including the various things that you kind of hope someone in that position includes, where she talks about the trajectory of the work, she includes bits and pieces from different versions or discarded versions and various explanatory notes and all of that kind of thing to be a bit more transparent about the process that she went through to produce the final version that appears here. Summarizing the ideas that are dealt with in this book is not an easy thing, particularly because it covers a really broad range, and it also does so in a way that doesn't neatly fall into categories that might be more familiar to those of us who are steeped in more conventional Western traditions of thought and of writing. One way to characterize what the book does might be as a sweeping exploration of world-making, of knowing, of self-making, and of creating. One of the things that Anzaldua does throughout her body of work, including in this book, is she draws on figures and images and stories from the indigenous side of her mestiza heritage, and she uses those as a way to organize her thinking and to communicate her thinking. So, for example, she talks about the process whereby trauma, and she, I think, is talking specifically about the traumas of colonization and racialization, though I get the sense that she is okay with these ideas being applied more broadly than that. But how these traumas of racialization and colonization can fragment self, and then there can be a process of drawing self back together, of healing, and of ending up in a different configuration than the one you started in. And to talk about that, she uses the figure and the story, and pardon my butchering of the pronunciation here, of Coyolxocque, who is a goddess who is dismembered, and then who draws herself back together even more powerful and beautiful than before. Another important concept that makes appearances throughout the various aspects of this book is the idea of nepantla, which Anzaldua uses to mean kind of the boundaries between kinds of difference, and she applies it to many different areas of difference, and nepantleras, who are people who exist in those boundary areas and who take up a particular kind of political and spiritual work, a change-making work that they are able to do because of being in that nepantla. So there are those ideas, there are various other important ideas that are most effectively learned through looking at the book as a whole, because she deals with them in different ways in different chapters. And then there are some specific things that she deals with in each chapter. So there's a chapter about imagination, which I think is interesting to read in relation to some other things that I've read in the last few years by other scholars about radical imagination. There's a chapter about various kinds of artistic creation as political practice. There is a chapter about her own writing process. There is a very sophisticated and powerful chapter on identity formation. And there's also the final chapter, which is kind of a synthesis that talks about, among other things, a kind of how the world exists, how it shapes us, and how we shape the world. So in terms of the aspects of this book that fall into that category that I mentioned before, of things that I completely respect but feel like I have to respect and learn from a distance, probably the biggest of those is the distinct ontology that Anzaldua sketches out over the course of the book. And I don't think I would even have recognized it as an ontology, and I should probably insert in here, ontology is a way of thinking about how the world exists. I don't think I would have recognized it as that if it hadn't been pointed out so insistently by Keating in the introduction as being a distinct approach to ontology. And part of why I don't think I would have recognized it as such is that it's very, very cleverly written by Anzaldua in a way that those of us who are inclined to take it up as, I guess, metaphor for phenomena in the social world as more conventionally understood and as imagery can do that and can still end up with some really powerful and useful ideas about the world. But I think it's really important that Keating points out in the introduction that that isn't what Anzaldua herself thought. It isn't what she primarily meant by this writing. That this work is Anzaldua invoking a world in which these deeply spiritual realms, in which this alternative to the dead matter that is central to most Western materialisms, this indigenous informed but not indigenous worldview is actually real, is very much a literal expression of how she understands the world to be. I respect that. I think there are definitely things that I can learn from that, but it would be dishonest of me to pretend that I can take that up, or that I don't see things in a way that's different from that. So that leaves the question, well, okay, what can I take up from this work, and how can I do that? And I think I don't have a final answer to that, and I think there isn't a final answer to that. I think part of the process of doing that is leaving it unsettled, of staying in the uncertainty and the discomfort of knowing that this is beyond what I can take up and can comfortably kind of box in and know. I think that that's important to stay in that space. And even to the extent that I do have some thoughts about it, they're not very satisfying even to me, so I don't expect them to be satisfying to you. But I do have some thoughts, so I will share those. So the most literal and obvious place where I can take up the rich work being offered in this book is the chapter on her own writing process. Now, it's a very different writing process from mine, but I definitely think it's something that I can learn from, and I certainly feel inspired by. I mean, I think the most obvious part of that is her commitment to rigor and to taking as long as it takes to write what she wants to write, which is a great reminder for all of us who do our work in this social media saturated age where there's this pressure to write quickly, to write frequently, and often as a result, I think, to write shallowly. So, I mean, there's that, but it's much deeper than that, because the way that she approaches the chapter is as a kind of intense, I don't know, autoethnography, I guess you could call it. And I just think there's so much to learn from her engagement with her own process. And I know I'll come back to this chapter at various points in the future when I go through my occasional but regular mini crises in reflecting about my own writing process. So that's the most obvious and direct thing that I can take up from it. But I think there's also lots in the political and theoretical content of the book that I can take up usefully and appropriately, I hope so, though I'm open to hearing that that's not the case, despite the fact that I can't fully embrace the ontology in which she grounds all of this work. I think the biggest example of that for me is the work that she does around self-formation and identity formation and how we exist in the social world. I think that's particularly true when you read what she has to say in this book, what Anzaldua has to say in this book, along with some work by Keating, and I'll link in the description box to a review that I did of the particular book of Keating's that I mean on this topic. And I think that the way in which, again, Anzaldua when read in relation to Keating, engages with the necessity of, but the limitations of, reified identity politics as they're most commonly seen in more mainstream kinds of contexts in North America today is very, very important. And I think it is far richer and far more sophisticated and powerful than the kind of smooth-tongued class reductionism that a growing subset, I think a mostly but not exclusively white subset of the anarchist and socialist left are using to respond to vaguely similar kinds of concerns. I think the approach outlined by Anzaldua and Keating, or an approach that draws on their work, is much more likely to lead to the kind of we, the kind of collectivity that we need in order to make progress in our struggles for collective liberation. So I want to continue to learn from that, and I encourage others to do so as well. And there are other elements of the book that I think that we can draw on, other things that we can learn from. I think, speaking on a more personal level, I think I still have things to learn from the way that I was affected when I originally read the piece of writing that became the last chapter of this book 15 years ago. And I think it's interesting because it did have that effect on me, and it did feel really useful, even though there were bits of it that I had to relate to from that distance that I've talked about. And I think in that experience, there's more for me to learn about relating to difference in the course of learning about the world. Not really sure what that's going to look like, but I think there's still something there. So there's lots more that I could say. There's lots more that this book made me think about, lots more that I think it's worth learning about. I think I'm going to restrict myself, though, to one more line of thought that was catalyzed by reading this book. And that is, it made me think a lot about who we learn from, whose ideas we take seriously, who we take up as we're wrestling with our own ideas and our own decisions about how to act in the world. And I should add as well, this is also to a certain extent informed by writing I've encountered online from feminist philosopher Sarah Ahmed, who also writes about citation practices and about the ways in which we construct lineages of politics and of ideas. But in reading this book, the thing that really crystallized it for me was this really clear sense of how important I was finding this book, but a recognition that there are a lot of other people, and I'm meaning specifically people who do engage with the world through books. It's, and this is not meant to disrespect people who engage with, learn about the world by engaging with it in other ways, but I'm talking specifically about folks who learn about the world through engaging with books, that there is a certain subset of people whose work as writers and whose political work on the ground I really respect, and I'm thinking primarily, though not exclusively, of a kind of subset of mostly white anarchist and socialist, mostly men, who would have no interest in this book. And who, if they did read it, would probably be scornful of it. I mean, they'd probably be scornful in private, not publicly, but they would be scornful. Or if they read it and they weren't scornful, they would give it a kind of token nod of respect, but not really grapple with it seriously as they went forward doing their own work of whatever sort. This isn't really about one book or about one author. It's more a recognition that that stands in for a whole cross-section of books and authors who have done really important radical work who aren't given the time of day by people who I also respect and whose work I also value. So there's lots going on here. I mean, I fully recognize we all have limited hours in the day. We all have limited capacity to engage with books and ideas and conversations and what have you. I also recognize that we can't get it all figured out before we act. We have to move forward and be having these conversations, asking these questions as we move forward. So we're not going to have it all figured out before. I also recognize that I do the same thing, maybe not along quite the same axes as I'm thinking about more directly, but I know that I do this because we all do it, because we have to, because it's a survival strategy to make these decisions about what we engage with and what we don't engage with. All of that said, I do think that there is something a little less understandable and a little more troubling going on here. I think that this is a way of relating to other radical traditions that we don't share, radical ideas, radical practices that we don't share, across that difference that is inculcated by graduate schools for those people who have that experience, and is also inculcated by political formations, Marxist political formations, anarchist political formations, that insist on a correct line, that correct line politics also encourages this kind of dismissive way of relating to other strands of radical thought and practice that we can learn from. And even given all of the practical reasons why it's also the case, I think we need to come up with a different way of approaching things. I don't have any magical answers about how to do that. I don't really have any immediate insights about how I should change my own practice, but I really think that we need to cultivate more complex, more nuanced, more generous ways of relating to strands of radical thought and practice that are different from our own. I think in that lies our best hope of constructing the we that we need to win collective liberation. Or, to express a similar sentiment, borrowing some vocabulary from Anzaldua in this book, it is through that that we have the best shot of moving from nos slash otros, which is we slash others, to nos otros, which I think is just we in a collective sense. I'm probably mangling the Spanish there, but you get the idea. Anyway, those are some of the thoughts that I had based on reading Light in the Dark by Gloria Anzaldua. If anything that I have said interests you, I encourage you to read it yourself. And I also encourage you to check out the description box below this video, where I have links to all of my social media presences and related things, as well as to the written version of this review. Thank you very much for listening, and I will be back again soon.